2021 organized by GCU ACM Student Chapter Lahore. The title of our third workshop is Back in Engineering with Node.js. Node.js has been gaining popularity in server-side development in recent years. It gives a unified development flow for a web-based platform. In this webinar, we'll discuss about software development lifecycle, that is, from concept to design to development and support. Very common interview questions, common JavaScript, Node.js caveats, and security-related issues. The importance of gradient control, Git, Bitbucket, SVN. Then finally, we'll go into a brief discussion about cloud platforms like AWS, its services like EC2 and Lambda, etc. Software development lifecycle, introduction to JavaScript and Node.js, gradient control, cloud computing basics with AWS, common interview questions. Mr. Muhammad Umar Asif will be the guest speaker for Back and Engineering with Node.js. Mr. Muhammad Umar Asif is a senior software engineer and has been working in the IT industry of Pakistan for the last 5.5 years. He completed his MS in Computer Science from Information Technology University, Lahore, and did his BS in Computational Physics from Punjab University, Lahore. Mr. Umar has been worked in health tech and fintech using Node.js and has been working in JavaScript technologies for the last 5 years. Now, without any further ado, I would like to welcome our guest speaker, Mr. Muhammad Umar Asif, to take part in this webinar.
All right, Assalamu Alaikum, and I hope that all of you are doing fine. So, let's start with this webinar. All right, so the title of today's discussion is Backend Engineering with Node.js. All right. So first of all, without going into Node.js right now, let's start with what is software development lifecycle. So as you can see in that, there are different steps in how we approach software development. So for example, first of all is planning, and then defining, designing, building, testing, and deploying. These are steps. There can be different opinions and things that which steps it lies where. But the thing is that generally speaking, and the name of the steps can be different, but generally speaking, more or less, these are the steps that we follow when we are trying to develop a software. So, and the thing is that in every step, we can go, for example, in planning, we can go into planning phase and then follow these steps again. It's sort of a recursive cycle, if you understand that in planning, you can go in planning, defining, designing, building, and testing and deploying. I mean, the outcome of planning should follow these steps. So it's sort of a recursive thing. So, and that's this architecture that we follow to make a good software. So what happens is in planning, we generally do is that we gather a lot of requirements. That is, we talk to the clients, we talk to the stakeholders for whom we are trying to build the software, or if we have an idea for whom is this software going to serve. So we try to go to those people and try to go to those stakeholders and take their feedback, and then or the client's requirement, if it's a client out there who wants the software to be developed. So we go there and we take their feedback. So, and this is the planning phase. We plan everything, we gather our thoughts, we talk to different, we have a lot of notes and everything. Then come the defining phase. Here, we actually lay down what we have learned from planning phase. What we do is we go a step by step and we define that, okay, these two people said this thing, but eventually this is the same requirement. So we lay down the requirements, what is required to do by the software. All right. So, and if you have any questions, please do raise your hand so I can see, and then I can pause and you can ask questions. All right. So coming back, so in this phase, we laid out every requirement and we see that, okay, these are the requirements. And so these, from here, now we go to the product designing phase. So design and architecture is the phase where we actually laid down that, okay, how these different requirements are and what are their implication on the software level. We try to then architecture, okay, so this is the server side computing, this is the client side computing, this is what will be done stored in the database, these are the fields that should be required to store in the database. So these kind of decision architecture, how one module will talk with another module, how things will go here and there, and how the communication will work. Are there mobile devices or not? Are there web devices? Is this web-only platform? It's a mobile platform. Is what type of platform it is? So these kind of decisions are taken in the designing and architecture phase. Then comes the building. So you can see that you don't directly, when we talk about software development, you don't go directly into writing code. Okay. So there's a lot of steps before that. And for students or for someone who's new, it seems like that why do we need to do those things, but these are important. Just jumping into code is not a good practice, all right? So you have to keep that in mind. And why do I say that? Because when you jump it directly into code, what happens is that you lose all of the things that you should have done in the architecture or in the previous phase, where defining and planning phase. So when you start writing code directly, so what happens is you write code and it turns out, okay, oh, this was not right. We need to do this like this. We need to implement this phase like this. So then you start changing the code on that level. And when the project grows a bit from a very small module, 4 or 5 modules to like 5, 15, 10, 20, 15 modules, so it starts to become very hard to manage that code because it's sort of a patchwork. It's not a very consistent design, well thought of software. So that's why we need to have these steps. So building. Building is the point where you would start writing code. We talk about senior developers who they will lay out the basic frameworks of what modules should be there, how one module will talk to other, what interfaces are there, what classes should be made, and all those kind of things. So there you will start building. And then comes the testing phase. You have created one module. Now you either yourself or you then send it over to the QA department. What they do is they start testing with the code. They start trying to figure out where your code breaks and what are the edge cases and those kind of they will play with your software so that they can find that it's robust enough to go to the next level. And the next level is deployment. Here, deployment means that once your software is ready, it's tested, even if it's a very small part, it's just one aspect of it. It's tested, and now we are going to deploy it into a server side if it's a server side code, or even if it's a website, we need to deploy it on some platform, some server where the website will going to be rendered, or it's an application for it's a mobile app, so you're going to deploy it on Google Play Store, App Store, Apple's App Store, or you're going to deploy it on the Huawei Store. Now, so basically, these are the deployment methods. And if it's and this app needs a server as well, if we want to communicate with other applications or somehow to the server client, so we need to deploy the server as well for those apps. But for apps, we have their platform. For websites, we have servers where the website is going to get it from. All right. So this is the basically life cycle, and then you go into again. For example, you have deployed one module of your application. Now you need to do it another module. So now you follow this cycle again. You will plan it out, you will define its requirements, you will start designing it, and then you will start building it, and then you start testing it and deploy it, and this cycle goes. So every module, every phase, this cycle goes. You need to follow these steps, because to have a very good functional code and readable code that everyone can hear and have a very application that is scalable, that is very well designed, and so for all those things, these are the steps that we need to follow. So this is basically what we call software development lifecycle. All right, so let's move forward. Let's talk about JavaScript. So JavaScript has been around for quite a while. And you do. First of all, you need to understand it has nothing to do with Java. All right. So Java is a separate language, and JavaScript is a very separate. Even though it's sometimes confusing, people think that, especially who don't have any experience with JavaScript and know about it, they think that it is some sort of a Java thing, and then some sort of derivation or some sort of linkage to Java. But it has nothing to do with Java. It was just, if we go back into history, back in the time in early 90s or mid 90s, Netscape was a company that first tried to basically implement this. So you have to understand that back in that time, websites were generally very very static. If they were text or images, a text would be displayed or an image would be displayed. You can't do anything more than that. There was a hyperlink. You click on that link, it will go to a next page. It will be a text feed or an image. That's it. No, nothing more than that. So people realized that this is a very boring sort of a thing. We need to have some dynamic element to it. There's different companies that started working on implementing a scripting language. So Netscape was the company that started implementing this language that we now know as JavaScript. So initially they called it LiveScript, but at that time Java was very popular and it was gaining a lot of momentum. So what they did was just a marketing trick that they named the new language that they created as JavaScript so that they can capitalize on the Java marketing. It's nothing more than that. It's just the name so that they could have, back in the time, capitalized that, oh, this is something related to JavaScript. And like what people think that it is something related to JavaScript, but it is not. It's entirely different language, it's scripting language. It does borrow some syntactical things from Java, but not anymore. We can't say that because Java is now a very different thing in present day. And JavaScript is now regularized by the ECMAScript, ECMAScript. So initially it was designed for browsers only to make the websites that we see more dynamic. Click elements, small pop-ups, or very small dynamic elements where information could be updated in runtime. So if some event has happened, for example, like you can imagine that in browser chat module, so they were not possible with static website, simply not possible. But with dynamic JavaScript, you can actually now make a small chat box in your website so that they can communicate with the server, send messages, and then get message because they are live message. So as you receive the message, so it can be displayed while without reloading both of the website using AJAX and those kind of technologies. So these were only possible using JavaScript. Otherwise, it was not possible with only static websites. So JavaScript was very, very important in evolution of web. So that's why we primarily, it was focused on the web browser only. So you can understand that it was very, very popular. People started using it a lot. So now it was then standardized by ECMAScript. So what, historically speaking, what happened was that everyone, like Netscape company back in the time in the early 90s, then Microsoft with the Internet Explorer, you would have relied on Windows XP or Windows, late Windows 7 even. They had Internet Explorer. So Internet Explorer had its own sort of live scripting language. And then there was a company called Macromedia. They had their own action scripts. So these were very different technologies. They would not talk to each other. And what ended up happening was that if one website was made on Netscape, it won't work on the Internet Explorer. And one website that was working on Internet Explorer will not work on the other browser. So there was no interoperability. So one website will be only optimized for one platform only. So that was a hassle for everyone, for developers especially, that you have to then optimize your website for every platform. And it just added pain in without any real gain out of it. So what then ECMAScript, it's basically, it stands for European Computer Manufacturer Association. So what they did was that they started to standardize JavaScript, so that this becomes one basic level of things that everyone will implement. That for every browser, no matter how they implement it, whatever their engine is, we'll talk about that. But no matter how they implement it, they need to implement this thing so that it becomes compatible with every other browser. So what? So why did this was required? So for example, Apple have their Safari platform. Microsoft have their now Edge platform. Mozilla has Firefox. So these platforms can open the same website more or less similarly. They have other features in them that are unique to them. That's fine. But at least they should be able to render the website. They should be able to open the website reasonably well across each platform. So that, first of all, the developers only need to implement these standards. And then once those standards are implemented, they get to know, okay, fine, this website will be displayed properly on every browser. So that's why these ECMA or ECMAScripts came into being. Now we have version 9, version 8, I guess, 6, 7, 8. So these are the script, they standardized JavaScript. So then engines, let's talk about a bit about these engines. So you might have heard if you have dabbled around into JavaScript, that there's a different one thing called V8, then there's a SpiderMonkey, then there's JavaScript Core, WebKit. These are the sort of the engines that people have made. So V8, Google's engine that runs in Chrome. So it's an open source platform. Actually, all of them are JavaScript is a web-based language, meaning that it's a just-in-time compiled. So a function that is required and we want to compute that function, it will be compiled on the runtime and then executed on the processor. So what's the benefit? You would have heard about compiled languages and then there are interpreted languages. So just-in-time compilation is a sort of middleware between these two languages, like interpreted language, purely interpreted like Python, or purely compiled language like Java or C++. So JIT is sort of a middle ground between those two. So what it does is it basically, whenever you write a function on it or whenever you write some code on it, it will weigh against its option that should I compile this function and store it so that it gives me a performance boost or it will not. So the engine decides these kind of things so that should I compile this code or not. If it find it that, okay, the compilation will give me a speed boost, it will compile it. If it see that it won't, so it won't. So these engines, and then again, every one of them are different. So everyone has their own technologies and how they implement these things, but they do all of them conform to the ECMAScripts. So V8 is Google's engine, so and upon which the Node.js is based on. SpiderMonkey is another engine that is used by and made by Mozilla Corporation, and it's used by Firefox, primarily the JavaScript engine for Firefox. Then we have a JavaScript Core or WebKit. It was developed by Apple. So they use it in their iOS devices and in their Safari or Mac OS. They implement this web JavaScript Core or WebKit. For iOS, it's called WebKit. For Mac OS, it's called JavaScript Core. So these are the engines that is used to run JavaScript. So let's talk about a bit about the language features. It's non-blocking and asynchronous. So more or less, these are the same thing. But just imagine that you have a website and you want to have it load multiple things. You have like three different images and one banner, and then you have a text, and then you have some information downside, then you have a chat module, and then you have it's a modern website. They have a lot of things going on these days. So just imagine that if a language is sequential, like for example, C++, when you did an IO call to a web server to get the image that you want to display on the header, then there's an image here and on the left side and on the right side, then the text area in between them. So if it's a sequential language, it will start to load the image first and the rest of the things are waiting. Then it will load the second image, then the third image, then the text information. So it will load everything sequentially. And you can imagine that this would not look very good for the person who is looking at the website, because it's it seems like it's very slow. The image is loading, then the next thing comes up, and then the next thing comes up. So what? So a better way would have been to parallelize all those things. Even in sequential language, we can do parallel computation. But what happens is, even if in parallel computation, if anything is on one thread, and then it will not complete unless there is the next thing won't execute unless there's the first thing that completes its execution. Or for example, one thread is responsible for loading all the images. So image one will be loaded, then image two will be loaded, then image three will be loaded, and so on. So a better way that JavaScript is designed to, and what how it does is, it's called non-blocking or asynchronous paradigm. What it does is that it won't wait for something that that needs to happen. For example, you have 3-4 images, and you load that website in the browser. You went to your URL, you said mywebsite.com, and enter, and it starts. What happens is that it will tell the web server, give me this text area, this is everything, send it to me. And when the web server replies, it's okay. We'd say that image one's first five lines, you can say, or first half of the image is this. The image two's first half is this. The image three's first half is this, because it's running in parallel. So the JavaScript then can understand, okay, fine. Okay, this is the image two's first half. Okay, put it here. This is image first one half. It put it here. So it feels like it does everything in parallel, but it's actually not. It is in happening in parallel, but what is going on in that, and it will send the completion of any task by raising an event. So it's also that, okay, so JavaScript will tell you that the image is loaded, okay, done. So the event is raised, okay, so this the first image is done loading, completed task. So the first image, even though there are multiple other images being loaded at the same time, so image two is done, and image three is done rather, because it was a smaller image. Image two is still loading. So these kind of things, it gives a very dynamic feel to it, so that everything is happening very, very quickly, and you can optimize the bandwidth of your internet connection so that it's used maximize the internet connection, so that it can use that bandwidth to load everything in parallel, and every when something is done, it will raise the events, okay, this is done, and we can do other tasks as well. So that's what is meant by asynchronous non-blocking. Means that in the context when we talk about Node.js, it will make even more sense there. So there are other things here as well. In JavaScript, it's a huge standard and it's a huge language. I'm not going into much detail about it, because obviously we can just talk about JavaScript all the time. But let's move forward and to Node.js. So Node.js is basically a runtime. It's a wrapper against based on the V8 engine of JavaScript of Google. So it's based on V8 engine. It's open source and cross-platform, meaning that it's an open source. You can go into its repo on GitHub and look at the code of Node.js and see what they have done. And it's cross-platform, meaning that it will work on your Linux distribution. It will work on Windows. It will work on Mac OS. It will work on pretty much every platform out there, even on IoTs and even on very small scale Raspberry Pis, or not Arduino. Arduinos are very, very small in competition, but on Raspberry Pis it works. On even mobile devices, I should say, but there are some caveats to that. Okay, so primarily used for server-side scripting. Again, the primary use of Node.js is for writing server-side, because as we talked in the last slide, that more life of JavaScript was before Node.js was introduced, was used for within browsers only. So it was used for making dynamic websites. Then the author of Node.js thought about, how about if we start using this platform for server-side as well? So what he did was that he wrote a couple of libraries, used Google's V8 engine, and I'm not remembering the author's name. Someone can post it as if they know. I knew about it, but not remembering. But that's not the point. The point is that what he did was that he took the Viet engine and then wrote about a couple of basic things to it again, like input-output, I/O. He wrote so that he can use that, and then there were a couple of other libraries he used. So with those, he made Node.js. So Node.js then was able to run in pretty much any environment, and then its primary target was to run in the server. So this gives a very unified structure to web development. You can see, because most of the websites were already using a lot of JavaScript in their front end. Lots and lots of JavaScript were being used for making dynamic websites, making it feel like more responsive and everything. So why not use the same concept to the server side? So it will, you don't need to learn any new language. You will just use JavaScript, and it will be using across every strata of the development lifecycle. So then, because initially what used to happen was, before Node.js, if you have a website that's front end, it's using HTML and JavaScript, on the server side, you had to use like .NET or PHP or some other language. And it was the added thing on the developer that you had to learn both of these things. You had to learn PHP or .NET, ASP.NET, or frameworks of PHP, because PHP is very popular, and Ruby on Rails or some other language that was done for server-side scripting. So you had to learn those. And then you had to learn JavaScript as well if you want to build front-end as well of your websites. So you can see that learning two languages and then thinking about their respective pros and cons, and what should be done here and what should be done there, right, on the server side, on the client side. So managing that can become a hassle, especially for freelancers and especially for very, very small teams. For big teams, they already have people for server side only, for client side only. But for small teams, for startups, it will become prohibitively expensive to hire people for respective technology. So JavaScript gave a very unified, and JavaScript and Node.js gave us a very important platform, so that you only need to learn JavaScript, and then you can basically do a full stack, as we call it, full stack development for server side. Even if you would need to know some databases and something about databases, but apart from that, developing servers and then writing client side with application and then protocols in between, everything can be done in just one language. So that was a very huge benefit for Node.js. Okay, so talking about its primary use for server side, and it's event driven single threaded, just like I told in the previous slide about JavaScript, it's also event driven and single threaded. So what's mean by these? Event driven means that whenever something is done, so it will raise an event. For example, you told it to fetch some data from the database. All right, very common scenario on the server side, we need to communicate with the database a lot. So what it will do is that it will go to the database and it will ask the database to give me that data. But in the meantime, it won't stop there. It will move forward to the next instruction. The next instruction is, okay, let's do this task. Let's compute some images for that we have in the cache. So let's fetch those. It will start fetching those. So, and it will keep on going till the database fetching is done. And then the runtime will raise an event telling you that, okay, this is done. And event, basically, we call that a callback. So it will give you a callback that we have computed this resource that you asked for from the database. Now what we want to do with it. All right. So it will give you a callback in the form, because it event driven means it raises an event, told the callback to, this is the data, tell the user, this is the data, now go in and start whatever you want to do with the data. And then that's the next step, that if you wanted to fetch some images, so it will start fetching some images, and it will tell you that, okay, these are the images, these are the callbacks, now what you want to do with it. So it's never stop. Java Node.js does not stop at any point. It's of its execution, it's always running, it's always doing, and it's always single threaded. That it has one thread, And if it crashes, for example, there was some error at that point in it, then everything crashes. No matter what's it doing in the rest of the parts of the server or whatever it was doing, everything crashes. So you have to be very, very careful that your platform or your Node.js application does not crash. You need to have some error handling in here so that whenever an error is, it is gracefully handled and so on. So you have to be careful that. But again, the benefit of that is it's very, very quickly responsive compared to the threaded model that was against ASP.NET or Ruby on Rails or PHP. Those languages use threading. This does not. This only has one thread for every request that is incoming, but it does it very, very quickly because of it does not stop for any response. For example, you can imagine there are two requests from two different users. One request is the user one asks for an image, but the user two only asks for some text. So what happens is that when in the meanwhile that the for image that is being loaded for user one, the for user two, the text that is needs to be rendered will be quickly fetched and displayed to the user. Meanwhile, the image for the user is still loading or happening. Fetching of that is happening. The user two was responded and he's done. And that's how you can imagine that multiple users can very, very quickly get resolved. It does not stop for any one particular thing unless you make it stop. You can do that, and you can see how. I'll explain when we write some code for it. So you can go to nodejs.org and download the platform, the runtime for your environment, be that Linux or be that Windows or Mac, whatever. So it will recommend what platform you're running. You can download it from nodejs.org and install it on your laptop, computer, whatever you have. You can then start playing. All right. So moving forward. So let's talk about a bit about these basic things, and then we'll write some code right now. All right. So npm. Npm is basically a node package manager. All right. So there's a lot of ecosystem that has been built around Node.js. So because it's open source, so people come up with a lot of their libraries, and you can do, and you should be doing that because. What ends up happening is that, for example, you are running into a problem, not problem, but you're running into a code section that you need to repeat, you need to make it repeat again and again. For example, a web server request is a very common thing. Then you need to send an external request to another server and then get data from that. And that is a very fairly common thing that we do. So rather than writing the code again and again, what you do is that you isolate that code, make a function or a module out of it, and then what you can do is then you can publish that module. If you can and publish that module to npm. Most of the npm packages that we're going to use, because it's open source, these are used by the community or made by the community and used by the community. So Node.js has a lot of active community around it. So it's a very, very interesting and a good thing that you should go and just look around that rather than reinventing the wheel, as we say, that rather than going there and then writing all that logic yourself, look out a package that already does that for you, and then you can start building your application very, very quickly so that you don't have to write a lot of things that you can just focus on your core business logic. All right, so npm is very good for that. But I will say one thing here is that we should be careful as well, because in the past there has been some malicious code attached to npm modules as well. So you should be careful about, you should read about the document of that package that we're going to use. You should see that where its origin is and what are other people saying about that package, because it's important. You don't want to be using a package that has been compromised in your platform, because then your platform will be compromised. Even though it's open source, but it can still happen that some malicious code is there which nobody looked at, or it was a very small package that nobody last at, or there was some other thing happening. There can always be a lot of things, even in open source world, that you should be careful. So just don't go out there and willy-nilly and just start using every package that you can find. Be a bit conservative about how you will use those packages that this npm repository gives you. So use them. There are a lot of that I'm going to use for you right now. but still be careful about the reputation of the package as well. How many the high popular packages already are very fairly commonly regularly used. So try to use those, stick to those kind of packages. And again, there's also one thing that some companies even mandate that you should not only, these are the approved packages, you should only use those. Apart from that, you're not allowed to use any other package. So you should be careful about that where you are working. So what are their regulations? What are they saying that, what are their appropriate list or approved list that should be using or not? Okay, so this was NPM. Package.json. So package.json is one of the first files that you're going to make in your project. So this file has a metadata about what your project is, what are its keywords, what its name, what are the dependencies that it has, meaning the lot of packages that it has, a list of packages, dev dependency, meaning the package that it got while developing. So this package.json file maintains all that. We're going to see this shortly when we're going to build a project. Very simple API. Express is sort of a very, very basic framework for Node.js. This gives you a lot of functionality out of the box to make simple APIs for your project. And API is basically application programming, but interface for. So let's talk about a bit about how server-side interaction and what are those for someone who have not came across these terms. So server-side is basically a centralized place where your code resides, and a client-side is every client that is going to talk with that server. For example, I'm a website, accessing a website here from my laptop. So I'm a client. I'm using this website on this phone. So I'm a client on the phone. So every device that is going to communicate with the server is a client, and every code that runs on that client is called client-side code. And the code that is on the server is called server-side code. So that's the server side. So this is called the client-server architecture that is very prevalent these days. And this is one of the core architectures of web. There are others as well, but this is one of the most popular and core architecture of web development. So APIs, we're talking about APIs. So API is an interface that is used to communicate between the client and the server. So application interface, this API is an interface which provides you, and there are multiple interfaces. You might have heard about REST API, you might have heard SOAP-based API. There are different APIs and different ways that they communicate. So these are the protocol between how a client will ask information from the server and how the server will get back that information to the client. So that's called an API, application programmable interface. So let's start some building some APIs. All right, so this is my terminal. I have already installed Node.js here. So what if I do Node here? So it will give me the okay, I have installed Node 14.16 and type helpful information. So for example, it's a runtime. So if I do this 1 + 2 equal 3, print out 3. So this is just basic Node.js, just to make you see that you have installed Node on your laptop or computer or whatever. So this is a good way to see, and it, whatever function that you want to write in your script, it should be working here as well. So all right, so I'll exit out of it. And okay, let's make a new directory. For example, okay, I'll make this directory. I'm in this directory, is Node.js. And what I'll do is I'll do npm init. So initializations, so it's small. So npm init. So it will give me a lot of information telling me that we're creating a package.json file. As I told you, that package.json is a very basic file, so which contains all the information. So it's asking me package name, no test, I will press enter, version 1.0. No, I would rather say that 0.0.1, because this is just a test application. You can have version, and different companies have their own versioning system. So, but the thing is that for version, this is the major, but the first thing that you see is the major version. Then there is a minor version. Then there is the build version. So this is the convention of versioning. So major, minor, and build. So it's asking me that, is your version 1.0? I'm saying no. This is 0 version and 0 minus. So my build is 1. So this is a very versioning system. So whenever you're developing some application from scratch, this is how you do it. When you go to production and deployment, then you raise it to version 1. So you would have seen that, okay, so if you play some games, so they say the game has been gold. So that is version 1.0. That's what the first version that is released to the public or that is released to masses, that's called version 1. So we are going to develop version 1. It's just different test project. Okay, entry point index.js. Normally it's index.js, but you can make any file, any name here, app.js, whatever, but index.js is a pretty standard convention that we follow. Test command, so right now, we'll come to that later. Leave it empty. We'll come to it later as well. Keyword, test, all right, author, license, I see there are different types of licenses. As well, you can, these are depending upon the company and the way you want to see that it's an open source license. Can it be modified? Should it not be modified and all those things? So these are the kind of licenses that, but you don't need to take much thinking about it. It only matters when you are going to release it and when you want your source control, your source code to be modified or not, and you can kind of think. So this is where it's important. So it shows me that this is the information that is going to be made. Is it okay? Yes. So notice if I do SLS, there's a one file package.json. All right. So now what I need to do is make another file called index.json. Yes. Because this is the main arg in entry point. Okay. So now I have index.json. It's an empty file. There's nothing inside it right now. So let's open it in an editor. I use VS Code. So so this is my editor. So as you can see there, here is the name of the file. Right, let me get to this later. The keyword, the author, and license. There is some other information as well as we're going to make the code. You can see that there will be other information here as well. So first of all, let's do this. What we'll do is, let's say console.log. All right. So all right. So you understand that what does this mean, right? This is the most basic thing. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll do node index.js. All right, so it prints hello world. Very, very basic. You can do this in the node runtime as well. And you can see that it's just one thing that is going to print it. Console.log, it will print to the console hello world. So it printed hello world. Simple, basic. All right. So now let's start with, as we were talking about Express. So let's install that. So what we'll do is npm install or npm I for shorthand Express. All right. So what it does is that it will install Express and save this to your package.json file as well. So see that it created a log file as well. You should commit this file. We'll talk about this. 50 packages and so coming back, we can see that there is a new file called package log.json. And then if you go here, dependencies express. So as you can see, this is something that was added by your command, the npm install. So it added the dependency and express. So this tells the project, by just looking at this file, that your project is dependent upon these the list of dependencies that it should have. So whenever you want, for example, you have another partner who's going to copy this code and start to add new features to it and wants to run this project on his machine. So what we'll do is just, okay, this is the dependencies of this file, and then install it, those dependencies, and then you'll be set to run this project. So you can see that this is a sort of a metadata where everything is collected about the project, information about the project. So this log file, what is this? This is a log file that is auto-generated. You should not mess around with this file by yourself because it's generated by the system, and the system normally use this. So what it does is that it contains all the packages that are dependent on the other packages. For example, this Express itself has a list of packages that it requires. So this has that information. So it will tell you that, for example, this cookie package is required, this cookie signature is required, this debug is required. These are the packages that is required by some other packages. So you can see that node module. This is another folder that was auto-created because these are the sub-packages you can say about from which Express needs to run itself. So you don't need to worry much about it, you just need to understand that what are these things. So what you need to do is now that you need to see that your packages are here, and whatever you use, you just don't use something out of ordinary. Just have this here so that your code is interoperable with other people as well. All right. So this is package.json. So index. So now let's use Express to make a very, very basic survey. All right. So let's use this. What we can do is const Express is equal to require Express. All right. So now we have. We have this Express that is required. So this is now in our file available. This package and every one of its features is now available to us. And now we will initialize it. Const app is equal to. Okay. So now this app is basically responsible because it's an instance of Express. So it's a sort of a server that is responsible for total execution of whatever that you're going to do with this, all right? So let's do this is the app, and let's define another constant called port. So port is basically in the client server architecture, whenever client server, so it can communicate it on a certain port. All right, so different, there are some standard ports. Basically, any port that is less than 1,000 number is reserved. Not everything, but for example, your normal web architecture works on port 80. It works whenever you write, for example, google.com and press enter, it will go to this server, Google server, and ask for port 80, and then for the URL, sort of google.com. Speaking on a very, very broad. So port 80 is the port that it needs to talk to the server because it knows that port 80 means HTTP request, or port 443 means HTTPS request if you're using a secure server. Or port 22 is for, I guess, SSH for if you're going to tunnel into different servers. So there are certain ports and they're specific. And for normally node project that we are developed, and this again, this changes when you go to deployment, things go a bit different. But for port, we can write 3000 for now because it's a pretty standard Node.js port as 3000. But you can write 9000, 8000, whatever you want, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 5, 6, 7, 8, whatever you want. It's just something that I'll show you how we access it. All right. So let's create our first server. So what I do is app.php. Listen. All right. First is port. At what port I need to listen, and then a callback. All right. When this when the server is listening to this, what will it do? I'll say console.log. Listening on port. All right, so I'll do this. So now let's run this and see what happens. Uh, this. It's not exiting. You can see that it does not exit from here. It's just listening now. Now this server is listening to the port 3000, and let's make a request to this port and see what will get me open. Okay. I said localhost 3000. Okay, so cannot get slash. What does this mean is that it went to the server, it asked for give me the base route, and the server said I don't have any base route. This is what it means. For example, if I stop the server, it will say site cannot be reached because the connection was reviewed that it does not find any server. And what does this localhost mean? So then clear this up as well. So right now, what you are building here, the port 3000, this node environment is running on your local system. So which Windows or Mac or Linux, whatever, they have this unique URL called http://localhost. So that is referred to your local environment on the platform that you're working on, laptop, computer, whatever. You have this environment, you can refer to as like localhost. So it will refer to the local environment, and on we have run this on port 3000. So it will refer to port 3000 of that code. So localhost colon 3000. This is how we write code. Eventually, if we don't write this, it will be looking for port 80. All right, as I told you, after if I say here port 80, and if I run it, listening on port 80. All right, and if I just say localhost, cannot get. See, so without port, it's the standard port 80 that it listens to. All right, so but we don't want that because it can become confusing when you go into deployment and into other advanced thing that we should not be using port 80 directly because that's reserved for client server communication only. So even for your local, even though it will work, this will work. But still, you should not be using it for your own development. So we should use 3000. All right. Okay. So now let's build something. Let's build an API from where that we can. For example, let's have a use case. We build an API where we'll pass two numbers in the URL, and it will return the sum of that number. Simple. So let's do that. All right. So that we can do that is by app dot. It's a GET request. So let's. It also has two parameters. So one is for example root. All right. So here, and then it has a callback. So. This is the protocol, this is the convention of Express. So it has a request object and a response object. We say there's a request and a response object. All right, so first of all, let's print what is being passed. Console.log, for example, what is being passed to us in the URL. So let's go it and it's passing the query parameter because we are not doing a post request, we are doing a GET request, and GET request we can have query parameters, and then we need to return it because otherwise if we don't return the function, so you can understand that it will be waiting and the client is also waiting. So for us, it's very, very important that every API request that goes, that comes or lands on your server, it needs to send a response. Even that is an error response, even that response is whatever that is, you need to send a response within a very specific time because otherwise your browser is waiting and waiting and waiting and for response, otherwise it will send a timeout error to the client and it doesn't look well. So you need to always return something. So we'll say res.send is a function. and send all right, so we'll send a hello to the world, hello world. All right, so and we'll going to print a query, and so let's run this node index. It's listing on port 3000, and now this is my browser. All right, so here it is. So let's do colon 3000 and hello world. All right, but if you look at the head, there is an empty object printed, meaning that there is nothing passed in the URL. There was no params in the URL. So let's do that. So for example, we have num1 and num2 with value 1 and 2. So if I do that, it again prints hello world. But now you can see that there is an object in the query params with the num1 and num2. This is called JSON object. This is a JSON that is called JavaScript object notation. So it's the standard protocol how we talk, client and server talks with it, passing data especially. It has some basic primitives like strings or numbers or arrays or, so these are the our booleans. So these are the basic primitive with data structures for those. And this is an object. So this is an object based communication that we have called JSON, and it's a very pretty standard communication between client and server. All right. So as I showed you here, we have num1 and num2 that was passed with the value 1 and 2. So you can see that you can say here num1, and it's always treated as anything that is passed in the URL here, it will be treated as a string. All right. So this is, you can see that it's 1 and 2 are in string. All right. So let's write some computation on it. So what we can do is that, now let's comment this out and see that one. All right, and copy this and then run this.send, and again you have what I do is num1 plus num2. All right, I'll send that. Restart the server because we need to change to take effect, and then like hold on a minute, this is not right. It says 1, 2, meaning 12. So this is not the sum of 1 and 2. Something is wrong here. So let's try to figure out what's wrong. All right. So coming back to code, we see that in the previous command, there was number 1 and 2, but these are as strings. These are not as numbers. So in JavaScript, when you concatenate, when you do this plus on two strings, it will concatenate these two strings rather than using them as a number. So for that, what we need to do is we need to convert this to a number, and we'll say that okay, this is a number. All right. So now, when we started to me that it does not know that what is the meaning of this number 3 in send, because send function only gets string as a response. So it can only have strings, it cannot have numbers in it. All right. So there are two things now. There is another function, or we can do it. We can all do this. Let's do this. And we have 3. All right, because it takes string as a number. But there are other methods or other functions available as well to us. For example, there is a JSON function. And this function will, because it converts everything. The send function can only send string because it needs serialized data to send that to the client. It cannot go and do with numbers or booleans or those kind of data types. It can only do with a thing that can be sent to the client in string form, right? Because input is also every time in the string form from the URL. But just JSON function, response.json, it can have any type of data. It can have numbers, it can have strings, it can have JSON objects in it. So when we do this, so if you do this again, I refresh it and it's fine now. It's three, printing three again, because now this is sending as a JSON data, and you can see that this is three number in JSON and it's three. So it's fine. It doesn't crash anymore. And we don't need to cast it to anything. All right. So this is how you can set up a very, very, very basic API. Then again, here, app.php, we have a post as well. Function and the callback that will be triggered, like what needs to be done, request, response, and we can say that this is a multi API. So now rather than doing this, you need to do this. All right. So now how this you can see that how this will affect. So when we do this and let me start here again, the server is started, and so now if I do this, it will give me an error, cannot get slash, because it does not know, there's no API with the root URL. But we have an API called what? Sum. Okay, so now if you do this, so you see three again. So sum question mark, the question mark tells you that the rest of the thing that after this is your basic, in parameters, your query parameters. These are the parameters that we have. After question mark, you would have observed this in many websites and URLs that whatever you want to input some parameters in the URL. So that's how you can do it. So there's a question mark in number one and two. There are other ways of doing inputting parameters in post itself, body, you pass variable in the body and so on. So this is how you can, now you can see that there's an API called sum. Your host. This is your host area. This is the sum API, and then you have the parameter. So again, so what it came into this, it cast it to numbers and returned it to numbers. All right. So very basic, very simple. Now you can have multiple APIs that can communicate with the client. So that this website localhost, when it's deployed to some server, it can then communicate with from anyone in the world. Basically, it will be available. Right now, it can only communicate within this laptop setup because it's not exposed to the world. It's not deployed. But you can then, once it's deployed to some specific platform, you can then start accepting requests from anywhere in the world. All right. So let's move forward to our presentation, shall we? So. Let me quickly find all right, good. So we made some APIs let's talk about some databases. All right. So we have multiple types of databases. Mostly of them are relational and non-relational databases. All right. So relational databases are the ones where you might have heard a lot about SQL, MySQL, PostgreSQL. So these are the relational databases. They have a lot of relational data and very good at maintaining those. So for example, I'm a user that uses user table. Then I have a table called activities, and the user is associated with those activities. So these kind of data that is very, very relational, that one user does this and the other user does this, and they should be related to each other somehow. So this is very well handled by relational databases. So MySQL and SQL are very good example of those relational databases. And pretty widely, MySQL is open source, and you don't need any license for this, and it's pretty ubiquitous and very commonly. Then come non-relational. These are more entries into relational databases called MongoDB or DynamoDB. MongoDB is an independent company. DynamoDB is owned by AWS, Amazon Web Services. We'll come to those later. So MongoDB or DynamoDB, I see a hand raised. Does anyone have a question? All right. Please, if you want to ask questions, please go ahead. I'm sure there will be a lot of questions and you want to ask me, so please go ahead. All right, so MongoDB. So MongoDB is sort of we call them document DB or non-relational DB. So document DB, what it does is that it stores data in documents. And what its power is that, first of all, that it gives you and that you just want to store it. So MongoDB is good for it. You can have unstructured data system, and you can store data here in this DB. And so it's very good for that, and it's pretty fast as well. And you can also technically have relations as well if you want to have one user table also refers to another table that is. It's dump or data for that specific user. You can do that, but that's not the power of MongoDB. MongoDB is more useful in the dynamic system where things are changing a lot, where requirements are not very well defined. First and second, where the data is very unstructured. You don't have a very structured data, because if you have a structured data, you should go with relational database, because you know that this is the data that you want. But if you have some unstructured data where you don't know that this field will be filled or this field will not be filled, and we don't know how the user will interact with the system, then using MongoDB or DynamoDB for that matter is very good. But for DynamoDB, this is for Amazon specific only. So it is only for AWS. You can't port it to other services or other platforms. So DynamoDB gives you a lot of power in the same regard that MongoDB does, but it has an added benefit that it is very, very highly scalable. So it gives you a lot and lot of nanosecond or millisecond level throughput, meaning you can do millions of transactions in DynamoDB and still it won't do anything. So it uses systems that are very, very huge and has a lot of unstructured data. All right. So this is the thing about databases. And obviously with Node.js, every database can communicate with Node.js. We have drivers for MySQL, we have for SQL, we have MongoDB drivers. So any database that you want to use with Node.js, its drivers are available. You can go down, install that package for that driver, it will install it too. And then there are something called ORM. So ORM is basically object relational mapping. So what it does is that you can make a model on your code level, and the same with the database, and it will map to each other so that consistency is maintained. So it's a relational mapping, right? So what it does is that, for example, if you want to fetch data from database, So rather than going to database and writing query yourself, what else provides this functionality that you it knows how to communicate with a database? You just ask it that give me the user with ID 15, get user by ID 15. So it will go to the database and you don't need to write any query. You just call the function of an OR and it will fetch the data from the database. So that's a very big benefit of using OR, and that you don't have to write any queries by your own for databases. But there's a downside as well to that, is the performance. If you're working on a very, very highly system that is very critical to time sensitivity, then using ORM adds multiple layers, because it needs to have its own layers from which the from which your query the query is constructed internally, and then we run it on the database engine. So ORMs basically, not to big extent, but some extent, has some performance hit to your request and response cycle in some milliseconds or something. But that, again, this is your analysis. The cost benefit, that how do you want your convenience, and can your system work well even if we has some latency to it, or some performance hit to it, or if you feel like that no, we absolutely cannot even spare a single micro or nanosecond, so then you have to write query and then you have to optimize it yourself, which you can do. So but ORMs are generally very widely spread, widely used in and they provide a lot of functionality out of the box, so that you as a developer don't have to hassle around with the writing database queries and optimizing those and then figuring out that what went wrong and all these things. So ORMs are also very good on that regard. So let's talk about a testing framework. So this is also a very important thing, especially when you're writing production level code and then you want to move forward and want to big projects. So testing is something that normally many developers just ignore it, but you should not actually. Once you get into the habit of writing testable code, it gives you so many benefits. First of all, let's talk about testing methodology. First is manual testing that you will eventually do. It's like what we develop the API right now. So we tested it out, we then go to the browser, we put in the URL and then see that result is the same, that we entered 1 and 2 and the result was 3. Fine. That is that gives us assurance that whenever, whatever these two numbers will be added, we add that to 2, then the answer will be 4. We add 5 or 4, the answer will be 9, and so on. But that is very simple arithmetic, and you can always extrapolate that it will also be always be true. But for example, you have some complex function which has a couple of if and else conditions, and which has some complex logic to it. Then it's not very apparent that you can always make some testable code, or you won't be able to find some edge cases where that code will fail. So writing test cases is very important for that, right? So writing test cases is very, very important for that. What we can do is, let's start with our API that we have already written, and write some test cases. So there are three types of automated testing. So there's unit testing. This is the base of the pyramid. We call it testing pyramid. What is that? Is that there are the base of the pyramid is called unit testing, meaning that it will be the most prevalent cases that you will write. In the number sense, these will be the most number of test cases that you're going to write for every function. The rule of thumb is that for every function that you write in your code, every function, especially the function that is not the controller function or the API function, though not those functions, but every helper function or a function, small function that you're going to write, you should have a test for that function. That will only test that function, all right? So this is the rule of thumb. These are the most, you can see that at the base, it's the biggest part of your project, and you will write the test cases, the unit test cases, and by name, it means unit. So you will be testing the smallest unit that you have in your, and the smallest function that you have, and you will try to cover those with unit test cases. Then we have integration test cases. So integration test cases is basically the API level test cases that you don't need to test what's internally going on. You're just going to send the request and get the response. So sending the request and getting the response and seeing that what you requested and what you got is right. All right. So this is how integration testing is. You don't need to worry about what internally is happening. What is the internal function that is this API is using? You don't need to do that in integration test cases. Integration test cases only makes verify that I made this API call and then I got this answer and it should be this answer, right? For example, in our case, we send one and two numbers and we got three answers, so it should be three, all right? So this is integration test cases. Then come end-to-end, E2E, we call it end-to-end testing. This is when you have a front-end, when you have a back-end, and you want to completely test a module from the user input to the API level and then go to the server side and then come back to the user input and the user input and the things that you should have been shown to the user, it's running fine. So that's called end-to-end, meaning that end-to-end. Go to the server, come back, and the complete cycle of the request that the user is going to see, that's called end-to-end. For our purposes, for server side, we don't use end-to-end testing as such because obviously this involves some front-end, but end-to-end is very important in the front-end world. So when you're doing some Angular projects or some React projects, end-to-end testing is very, very important there because they need to test the front-end, the test whatever the response that are coming from the from the server is fine and everything is displayed fine and everything is working well. So that's where end-to-end testing. And this is very small aspect. This is the top of the pyramid. This is like for every major module, you'll have one test that will completely test that module. These are the way you can imagine that if your product has five modules, you'll have only five integration test cases and maybe have like 10, end-to-end test cases, five. Then you can have like 15 integration test cases and then might have like 100 plus unit test cases. So this is how testing parameter is. So let's write some, let's go back to our code and write. And first of all, let's do this in the function, all right? So what I'll do is I'll make a folder called helper and I'll make a new file in it called, for example, sum.js. This is just a file that will do this sum and return it. So what I'll do is I'll write a function here called const sum equal to just a sec. All right. So I need its parameter num1, num2, and then I'll have it. All right, simple, very, very basic function, but we won't be able to use this function. Why? Because this is an isolated file and the project does not know how to access this file. So we need to expose this function. How we can do that is we can write module dot exports. All right, so this is an object that will tell the project when the node will run that okay, we need to export this. This is multiple function, so we'll export this function as sum. All right, so now we can use this in this file. All right, so how can we use this file? What we can do is we can const sum equal to require, just like we did for our external packages, we can do the same with our internal ones as well. So this dot slash represent that what in the current folder that I have, go to the current folder, there's a directory called helper, and in that helper, go to the sum. You don't need to write JS at the end because it works fine both ways. So go there and do this. So, but again, it will import everything that's inside this exports file, all right? But we need only sum right now. So what we can do is either we can write sum here, and this will now become the sum function. All right. So this will be directly this function. input and you want to give cos sum is equal to also dot sum. All right. So now we from helper, you can see that if you go to helper, you can see that this is all the functions inside this helper file. We can have, for example, we can have multiplication here, we can have division here, whatever. But now we can, now we have some function that is from helper.sum. All right. So rather than using this, like this, this, so what we can do is we can comment this out. Result is equal to sum, and it will ask for two numbers, num one comma num. I'll pass num two. But there's a caveat here as well. All right. If I return this, this again, the thing is that here it will be passed as strings, not as numbers. So what we need to cast it as numbers. All right. So again, this is a simple function. We have casted it and we return the result. Let's remove these comments. And so let's run this. Okay, so I'll close this and there, and it's listening on the code this, and now if I do this, number is not defined. All right, so understand what happens. So again, the thing is that I have passed num one, but it should be not like this. This is the request dot query dot num, right? Because we have that. So try to read the result. Sometimes that you make errors, and so the errors most of the time are pretty self-explaining. So you should read the errors at what it's saying and then figure out that what's wrong with the code. So if you do this now, so now the result is 3. All right. So now we have a function that that takes this sum function that takes these two numbers in the string form, and then it passes it to this function, and then we have this function that will compute the sum and then return it. Simple. So now we need to run some tests for this. Let's make a unit test for this sum function so that we make sure that it will work for any new changes or anything that we want to have. All right. So for testing, there's another package that we're going to install. It's called jest. So npm I jest. Npm I jest. So jest is basically a package that is used for testing. It can be used for integration testing and unit testing both. So I'll show you unit test cases were out right now, so then we'll get back to the presentation and then see if we have some time, then we'll do some integration test cases as well. So it's a big package, it will take a bit of time, so it's taking a bit of time because it's a big package, but it's a pretty standard package, so it gives you a lot of functionality out of it. And so I'll show you how to write these numbers. All right. So we have now installed this. So if you go to package.json, so you can see that we have it here in jest dependencies. But this is not actually right because testing is normally done for developers and if you want to deploy something, not on the production website. So what should we have done is there's a parameter called dash dash save dev. So what it will do is that it will, if we do this, what it will do is that it will save these dependencies into another header. just let it just finish and then I'll show you on technical tracing, but it will have a depth dependency. What it will show you is that these are the dependencies that only developer while developing you need. For example, you need linting or code quality checks and something. These are the kind of things that only you are required when you want to, when you're developing your code. Those things are not required in production because it will only make more files and more your server big in that regard. So we can separate these two dependencies and you can talk about other. See, so now you can see that it has moved express just from dependency to dev dependency. All right, so you can see that just now in dev dependency. So whenever you will run npm I on a production server and it know that it's in a production environment, it won't install the dev dependency. It will only install the dependencies that are critical to the system. All right, and now that we're talking about in the package audition, let's have another quality of life improvement. All right, so in scripts, what you can do is you can write more scripts, your own scripts. For example, star. This is a script that I want to write, and what it will do is you can now run command here, node index.js. All right, this is the command that we have been running, but we can now write it as a script, right? So you can see that now there's a test command already, but there is a testing functionality. So now we just write jest. So jest is also available to us in the command line. So it will just run the test files. And I'll show you how it will do that. So now if you see that, again, if you go to our server, so how to run these scripts that you have made here. So what you can do is npm run star, the name of the script. So now again, it will tell you that node index is running on port. Exactly the same, but it gives you, because in big projects, what ends up happening is that this you have multiple other parameters running in production, running in local environment, running in multiple different configurations. So it can get confusing. So this is a very simplified way, rather than writing all the commands down and copy pasting it somewhere. This is give you this Node.js package or JSON gives you this out of the box functionality. You can write your own script test. You can have any number of scripts that you want. Here, just write a script that you have a command that you want to run when you want to do some specific task. For example, you want to run code quality. You want to run code quality check using ESLint, for example. Just a tangent there. But you can write, in, for example, here, you can write lint or code quality. And I have a command here called ESLint. And this will check your code quality and give you errors on that this is your indentation is not right, your code is mismatching, and those kind of basic code quality checks as well. So you can have many different scripts here. All right. So coming back, we have now installed jest and we have a sum function. So here now you can make a new folder. For example, you can not in help, you can make a new folder called test. All right. So now here you will find sum.test.js. So this is important, dot test, because jest will recognize this name as a test file. So sum is the function that is going to test, and the test.js, it will jest will recognize this file as this is going to be a test file. All right. So let's start writing a test. First of all, we need to import the function that we have used. So for example, just like we did in the index file, we'll do sum. We need to import this function require. And what we'll do is that we now, because we need to go one directory above, so what we'll do is like this, two dots will go to above directory, one dot is current directory, right? So helpers and then sum. All right, and dot sum as a function. We have imported this function. Now what we're going to do is we're going to describe that what our test bot is going to do. Describe, and again, just like I mentioned that we have, well, the first parameter is the text string addition, right? Then we have a callback. All right, so here now we are going to write this test can have multiple tests into it. For example, it can just like, let's say, test. All right. So, for example, here we are going to test add 1 and 2, for example, right? Which should be U3, right? Simple test. And now we are going to write its callback. But when this happens, what it does is it will expect, right? What expect that you want to expect something from. So you will say sum, and you will pass it numbers rather than let's pass it string to make our case even more strong. And 2. All right. So when I pass 1 and 2 as string to sum function, expect to be, this is the chess convention, to be 3, right? So this is our first test, for example, let's just run this first and then we'll follow it from here. Okay, so now we remember that we have a command called test. It will run chess and running fast. See, you can testing addition, just like it will testing addition, added 1 and 2 should be 3, it took 2 ms, right? This is how you can always be sure that your sum function will always be working correctly. Let's have another test. Let me copy this. For example, add 1.5 and 2.5, right? Let's make it a bit complex. So that we cover our bases. So, and 1.5 plus 2.5 should be what? 4, right? So, let's say we don't change this to be 3. Let's say what happened. Let's see what will happen. So, it failed. 1 passed, but 1 failed. Why it failed? It will expected 3 but received 4. All right. So now your test is failing because it was expecting an answer 3 but got 4. So see how you can actually make your test to fail as well. But ideally it should be 4. And how let me elaborate on how this will help you in code. So see now these two. Both test passes. The test suit was 1 and 2 test pass. We both have now 1 and 2 and 1.5 and 2.5 should be 4. So, for example, if someone new comes in and changes something, for example, by mistake they did this. All right, and then you go rather than debugging everything, rather than going back and finding out where the change is, where the issue is, why is something not working correctly, what happened, and going back into code, scanning all code. If you have your unit test cases, it will immediately tell you that where this thing is wrong. It expected result 3, got 12. Here, it expected 4, but got 1.5, 1.5, 2.5. And here, you can see, oh, this is concatenating. This is not adding them up. So you go to the function. This is the problem. All right. So you reverted it. You fixed it. Now when you run the test, and everything passes. So this is the power of testing, right? So this gives you the testing will give you this freedom of and peace of mind that whenever you run your test cycle. Even if someone changes the code and your test was fine and the test is not messed with, your test case will directly point to that this is where the problem is, this is where the problem is, fix it here, not scan the whole code base and not scan everything. And in the similar regards, but there are a couple of things that needs to be done. We'll see that if you have some time, so we'll do that. So debugging, the thing then debugging is the another technique there where you want to see that how your code is misbehaving. All right. So debugging is basically you want to track that what are coming in, what is very, very important. So let's look at debugging using this out of the box debugging and things. This VS Code provides out of the box debugging for Node.js and a lot of other applications as well. So for example, so one of the most basic thing that we need to learn about debugging is first you need to run the code from this platform, right? So for example, here we stop our server. So there is nothing running in the server. So the server, it's not really the debug, all right? So we will select Node.js because it's a Node.js application. So it will start. Okay, so it automatically started. It read the script. It started node index.js. All right. So listening on port 2000. Fine. Our code is running now. And then we need to set breakpoints. As you can see, if you hover here in the between the line numbers and here between this section of column, so you can see that there's a red icon here. So when you click on it, this is called a breakpoint. So whenever a line, whenever the execution is at this line, it will halt, it will stop. Let's see how. Let's go to this sum number and let's refresh it. And then when I refresh it, it came to this API. Then you can see that now it is highlighting that this angle means that this is where the execution is right now, and it's this is called here. So this is the local variables and this is the call stack. I don't want to go into detail too much about this, but let's here call stack, and this is watch. So basically this is the request and response objects that was passed in, and that this variable is undefined, result is undefined right now. See, because we have defined the result, but this function has not returned its value. All right, so there are two shortcuts, and here you can see as well. This is step into and then step over. So if I do F10, it will step over, meaning that it will compute sum, but it won't go inside that sum function. And if you want to see the value, for example, what is the request object? See, you can see there are a lot of things in the request object, a lot of things. So and then the query, this is the object that we printed, right? So you can see that in live. What is the data in this format? There's a 1 and 2. If you go to number 1, it will exactly show that the value of this number is 1 and the value of this number. But in query, if you hover here, it will show that this is the values of the number. But here you can also, if for some reason it's too big and you can't read it, and there's a lot of information, what you can do is in this live debug. So you can go and write, and it will show you, okay, this is the value of the numbers. You can write req dot. So helpful if you have huge big data and numbers and values and objects. So sometimes it's helpful if you can just quickly do it here in the debug console. All right. So, but we want to go inside this function with this sum function. So this is this arrow you can see, step into F11. That's the shortcut, and step over is F10. These are the most two common. And if you want to continue the execution, then F5. These are pretty standard for which is VS Code environment and shortcuts. So let's go into the sum function. So you can see if I went into the sum function, it came here to the sum file, and now you can see that it has 1 and 2 in the parameters, right? So, and if you want to see, because this is just one line, and you want to see what will be the value of only this part. So what you can do is copy and put it down here and see. So now is it's number one. It's not just string one, it's number one, right? So this is how you can copy chunks of different part, because this is one line and it won't hover over it, because it will only tell the value of the variable. But you want to see that what will be returned, for example. You can copy this complete line and compose it here, it will return number three. Right? So what we'll do is that we can't go further into this because this is R, like we can actually, but should not, because otherwise it will go into its own library as a function. So let's move forward and we'll press step over F10. It has computed the number now, because the execution at this point means that this line is computed. All right. So now step over. Now it's back. So now result contains 3. Right. So the result value is 3. And now, so you can see that now it will return this value. And when I do this step, and this is the end of the function, and it has completed. But again, see, if you do this, it will go into a lot of things that it eventually merge its handles. So it has stopped. So rather than going into those, just click go execute. And what you will see on the browser is you will have 3 answers here. This is a very, very basic way of doing debugging and seeing that how your code is behaving, what are the values, and why something is not behaving like it's supposed to be. So this gives you a very good understanding of your code, right? So let's start, come back to our presentation. So debugging, this is very, very rudimentary basic level of debugging. All right, so version control. So earlier we talked about version, what it is. So version control is basically how you can manage your code. And when working in different teams, how code is managed, because for example, one team member is working on one aspect and the other team member is working on another module, and the third team member is working on a third module. So how can you make consistency out of it? So that's where this version control comes in. It's called, and it's not necessary for using for code as well. You know that there are many, many authors that write and use Git or with this version control to write books, because it's just a text-based repository of managing code. What you can do is, for example, you wrote a chapter of a book and you don't want it to be in the main book right now. You want to work on it, you can make a different branch of it and you can work on it separately without doing a disturbing the book. And the functionality, apart from just coding thing, but primarily it was developed by the person who wrote the Linux kernel. He made this tool called Git. And we have a lot of services around GitHub, Bitbucket, SVN. So this is a lot of functionality to manage your code. It will become a bit, it will take a lot of time if we go into details right now, because our time is already, we're approaching 1 p.m. So I won't go into too detail, but if someone wants to talk to me later, we can surely do that. But let's talk about Git. This is something important that you might be wondering, for example, that in a project, we have this file called node modules. There's a lot and lots of packages inside here, right? So how can we make sure that this does not get into the repository, because this is a redundant file. Anyone who's going to start using this code can do npm install and get all this modules from npm repository. Why should you commit them to your code repository and make your code repository unnecessarily large? Because optimizing your repository is very, very important so that you get quickly code commits and everything. So normally the practice is that here we will have a new file .git.gitignore. You can see again, and here you can define node. All right. So when you define something and you have a repository with Git here, and you define a Git node, so now a node module is inside this. So it will ignore this folder now. It won't commit it into your commits and different code management things. So you can have as many files you want to ignore. You can have a lot. You don't want testing to be submitted in the code. But again, for your use case, for example, you can write in a Git repository. If the VS Code would have recognized it in a Git repository, read this out. Normally, because it knows that this is ignored now. But as big, this is not in a repository as of now, so this is not recognizing it as grayed out. So just a thing, but this is an important aspect of Git and Git ignore. All right, so deployments. So there are multiple options for deployment. There's Heroku, there's AWS, there's Google, GCP, Google Cloud Services, there's Microsoft Azure. So there are a lot of functionality. There's another platform called, there are many, many different, these are the standard international ones. You have local, in Pakistan, you have a lot of services that gives you hosting and deployment options. Then there are a lot of GoDaddy, or those are companies there that gives you hosting plus web names and whatever. These are the big, for any company that you're going to work with in the future, they generally have their own accounts and they manage everything internally so that they don't have to expose any information outside of their company. So they manage everything inside. So generally they would have a Google account or a Microsoft Azure account or AWS account or maybe a Heroku account. Heroku is a very good service for that. It gives you a lot of functionality out of the box and you don't need to build anything apart from that. So AWS, I'm sure many of you would have heard. If not, let's talk about a bit more in AWS and what is cloud computing. All right, so what is cloud computing? You have heard, I'm sure many of you would have heard a lot of buzzword that cloud computing, this is the cloud and these are services and so. But what is cloud? What is a cloud computing? Cloud computing refers to the model of only paying for the resources that you are going to use. No more, no less. That's what encompasses cloud computing. All right, so cloud computing is basically, initially what used to happen was that people would have servers in their premises, a lot of big, huge, giant servers, and then they would then have those running in the power consumption, CPU usages, and sometimes they didn't end up having that being used entirely. They have towers and towers of servers that are not being used. So that is something that used to happen a lot. But with AWS, what they did was that they made this infrastructure as a service, is called IaaS, that cloud computing, that you only pay for how many resources that you're going to use, and it only charges you when you are using that service, support, not after. If you stop, for example, EC2, this is Elastic Compute basically. So Elastic Compute Cloud. So this service will let you make virtual servers in Amazon and have make your application deployed to those servers. So this will give you that functionality that whenever the server is up and using the resources, it will only that amount. Not if you stop the server, it won't charge you. So we have multiple other functions. Lambda is a very classical function, services of AWS. They give you a functionality to run massively in parallel a lot of functions that are very small in nature, and you want to scale them out into tens of thousands of functions running. So that they give you this functionality. They have API gateways, Route 53 is for domain name, and then RDS is for databases, and then there's so many other services for AWS. But you have to remember that cloud is basically pay-as-you-go model. That's what cloud is. You use a resource, you pay for it only then. So that's it. So this is just a very brief touch on what cloud is. I'm sure we can go into lots and lots of details about it. So I think we have covered a lot of basics, and it's been quite a while now. So if you have any questions and comments, please, I'm here and I'm all ears, and please ask questions now. Then we'll conclude this session.
All right, guys, everyone, anyone who has a question, please raise your hand so we can unmute your mic. I guess no one has a question. I think your session was quite thorough, sir. Assalamu alaikum, sir. This is Sahil Asif, Society Manager, Education Student Chapter. I would like to thank you on behalf of our society, and especially our advisor, Sir Muhammad Hafiz. We would like to offer our gratitude for taking the time out to attend this webinar and give us all this valuable talk. And once again, thank you so much for joining.
You are welcome, and I hope that people who are in this talk with their attendees have some information, some understanding, because every slide and everything that I discuss is just, I skimmed over a lot of things. These are the kind of things that I've learned over the years, and condensing it down to this 1.5 hour short is a difficult task for me as well. But I hope that
I think it did give us a broad context of the things, and I think it was a very thorough and summarized session, and a good one also. Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right. Take care. Thank you so much for joining. Take care. Allah Hafiz.
Take care, sir. Allah Hafiz. All right, everyone. Now is all right. Yeah, Hassan, can you make sure? Am I audible right now? Just switched over to the other.
Yes, you're audible.
Okay, all right, everyone. Now it's time for attendance. We will be displaying a slide on your screens that will contain a link. Right? It will only be open for 2 minutes. Everyone, kindly be attentive. Only 2 minutes that link will be open. You have to mark your attendance within those 2 minutes. Otherwise, no excuse will be entertained about that. Also, remember that you should have all Gmail's login before filling the form. Otherwise, the form will not be filled.
Sahil, just a second. We have to announce our partners.
All right. Partners, pehle announce kar
dein. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for us to display some of the messages given to us by our collaborators, what they'd like to share with you. First, we have the message from IEEE LUMS Student Chapter. We are proud to have them as our collaborators for this event. We at IEEE LUMS, like our siblings all around Pakistan, stand to do our part in promoting technological progression and implementation of technology in the Pakistani society. We host numerous workshops, seminars, and competitions throughout the year. We have two flagship events, Coding Guru, which stands for, and our soon-to-be competition for the Electrical Engineers, the LUMS Engineering Olympiad, or LEO for short, which is sure to be just as impactful and grand as its CS counterpart. That was it for IEEE LUMS. Next, we have our collaborator, ACM Student Chapter from Komsach University, Islamabad. A very warm welcome to you all at ACM COI Lahore, chapter of the world's largest association for the advancement of computing technologies, ACM. We are working to create a platform that provides information and knowledge in a simple and attractive manner. We hold different seminars, events, and workshops in which experts from the field interact with the students and also provide an insight about professional life. Some of these regular events include Major League Hacking, includes seminars and lectures on different topics by professionals. DICE is an industrial exhibition where different projects and FYPs are exhibited. Semicolon provides an easy way of learning OOP, DSA, and basic programming skills. Code Red is a coding competition that is helpful in blossoming your programming skills. These are just some of the eventful happenings at ACMCUI Lahore. Thank you. Next, we have IEEE Student Branch of the University of Engineering of Technology, TEXLA. IEEE basically stands for Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers. Our society, IEEE Student Branch UET TEXLA, is one of over 2,000 student branches across the world. IEEE Student Branch UET TEXLA was initiated back in 2009. It is one of the most active and dedicated branch of IEEE Islamabad section, which provides an opportunity for its members to begin networking in their areas of interest and future profession and to develop a sense of understanding regarding technical as well as non-technical issues through its various events and workshops. Currently, IEEE's SPUET TEXLA has its WIE affinity group and two student chapters, IEEE Consumer Electronics Society and IEEE Power and Energy Society. IEEE SBUET TEXLA has won many awards at section, national, and global level. Some of their major events include Graduate Mentoring Program, Digital Design Roadshow, Worldwide HULT Prize Competition, Electra. Electra is a major technical event which offers the student to take part in several competitions and to showcase their skills. A total of 12 ambassadors was elected from the IEEE SB for the internationally celebrated PES Day 2021. Currently, there are 27 international active IEEE members working in the society. You can follow them using their social media handles for all updates. Thank you. That was it for all our collaborators. Now, I'd like you all to know that we will be joined shortly by Dr. Rashid Hussain, who is just a I'd like you all to know that we will be joined by Dr. Rashid Hussain for our upcoming webinar, Friend or Foe, on the role of artificial intelligence and machine learning in cybersecurity. It will begin at 1:30. The link will be the same. I'd encourage you all to join us. Stay tuned and join us for our next webinar. Dr. Rashid Hussain is the Associate Professor at Annapolis University in the Russian Federation. He's also the Director of Institute of Information Security and Cyber Physical Systems. He's also the head of networks and blockchain lab as an ACM distinguished speaker, as well as a senior member of IEEE. Now we'll shortly display a slide that will have the link for attendance. I'd like you all to please